Welcome to the Put On Waivers Media Group, home of the Put On Raiders podcast and the Student Body Right podcast. This is your place for the best breakdowns and the best insight for those who fight on and bleed silver and black. Now, here are your hosts, Dwayne Douglas and Ryan Holmes.
And welcome, everybody, to another glorious episode of the Put On Raiders podcast. I'm your host, Dwayne Douglas, along with Ryan Holmes, and we are podcasting on the beautiful shores of the Pacific Ocean. Beautiful day out here. This is the picture-perfect day out here in Southern California. Ryan, how you doing today?
Doing good. It's a gorgeous day. A little hot, but it's a nice day.
RTPOW podcast is my Twitter handle, and RHOLM22 is Ryan's. Please subscribe and subscribe again to the podcast. And then also hit us up on wherever podcast you're in a car, you're on the treadmill, go ahead and click subscribe on the link for I can't think of any platforms all of a sudden, on Apple and anywhere else you can find iHeartRadio, wherever you can find podcasts, we are available there as well. So a little something different now, because I got a couple of news things I want to talk about real quick, and then we're going to go into our list. We have five favorite play callers going into 2022, and then we have the five Raider receivers, not of all time. We didn't include people we didn't see, so when you don't see Cliff Branch on this list, you know, you can hit us up, but don't hit us up and say, where's Cliff Branch? Only guys who we have seen play, which the list is not as let's just say my father's list would be better than my list as far as the Raider receivers, as far as that goes. First of all, I did see a story about Nelson Aguilar talking about wide receivers, that he might get cut by the Patriots. They've been hearing that for a while now. Do you think that the Raiders are set at wide receiver, or do you feel like they would, because of the relationship that, I mean, listen, the head coach knows him, and also the quarterback knows him. Do you think that they would be, if the money was right, they would bring back on Nelson Aguilar?
I would think if the money's right, they definitely consider it. It's what does McDaniels think of Aguilar's receiver? Does he trust him? Does he trust the hands? Does he trust him to run the right routes? Obviously he knows the system, he was in it. And then it's going to come down to the contract. I, if he was to come over, I don't think the Raiders are going to offer him anything close to what he got to go to New England. He's probably looking at a one-year prove-it deal, you know, somewhere with the opportunity to earn up to maybe $5 million. Maybe it's a one-year $3 million deal with $2 million incentives. There's not going to be a ton of targets for him. Mm-hmm. Not the number that he got his first go-around with the Raiders. So it would have to be a fit, and he'd have to want to come here. And one, I'm not even sure he gets released. I think that's just a story at this point. We're so close to training camp. Yeah. If they were going to move on from him, they probably would have already done it.
Yeah. There's a receiver in Pittsburgh, not named Deontay Johnson, who is proclaiming that he is going to be the third best. He's the third best receiver in football. Chase Claypool. It's weird. Like, Pittsburgh will pick these receivers and they end up being pretty good, but it seems like, I mean, like, sometimes they just start getting a little yappy at some point. Chase, simmer down, calm down. Also on ESPN today, Ndamukong Suh got, you know, whenever somebody mentions the Raiders in any way whatsoever, he was asked about joining the Raiders, you know, with the offensive line. And then he had a response that he's been in contact with. He talked about it's an attractive situation, AFC West. And then also talked about, he said, hey, I text, Max Crosby, text Chandler Jones as well, too. So what are your thoughts about, I mean, we on this program, the Put On Waivers podcast, we are pro bringing in Ndamukong Suh. Is that just posturing, or is he looking for, obviously he's been a guy who goes wherever the money is.
Yeah, this is money at this point. I'm sure he's been offered a contract by an organization or two. It's probably not to his liking, or he'd already be there. Or this could be him just, you know, not wanting to report for the first couple of weeks of training camp, and then, you know, coming in, you know, midway through training camp, as some veterans tend to do towards the tail end of their career. So he may have an idea of where he wants to go. He's waiting for either more money, or he doesn't want to be there for the first couple of weeks of camp, would be my guess.
Yeah, as far as that goes, I agree. I agree with that part of it. So let's roll with the first one is the top five play callers. So I'm gonna pull up my notes real quick. So I'm going to, and this is kind of based off what they did last year, and I probably will say their name and then kind of give a point to like why I feel like they're in my top five. I would say one of five is Josh McDaniels, not because he's the Raiders head coach. I just feel like they've always been a really, watching that offense on film, you know, sometimes, you know, you kind of have to look at the quarterback situation as well. Like the play was called, so a lot of times, especially in the fringe red zone area, the play was called correctly. Hunter Henry is like this with a hand up and he's beating his man by 3 or 4 yards. The design is good, but sometimes Mac Jones wasn't able to give him the ball. I thought Mac Jones had a decent year at quarterback. I think the versatility in which he calls his plays is something that I like a lot as well. Like, you know, the game in Buffalo where they just ran the ball the entire game because of the elements. He is coached in all kind of situations. I've seen playoff games where they have nothing going on and then all of a sudden they call a trick play and then that jump starts the offense. You know, Gronk is, you know, my theme here is too, is like when you know where the ball, everybody knows where the ball is going. It's going to Gronk, it's going to Edelman, but they still get it to him on a consistent basis. That's really amazing play calling in a lot of ways because these teams are scheming to stop that all the time. So my number five is Josh McDaniels.
Yeah, I did not include McDaniels in my five. I tried to mix it up. I have two offensive and three defensive play callers here. With number five, I went Kyle Shanahan at San Francisco. I just think, he's gotten to the Super Bowl with Colin Kaepernick. He's gotten to the Super Bowl with Jimmy Garoppolo. It doesn't matter who's running the ball. It doesn't matter who the wide receivers are. A lot of it to me, too, when you start talking about play callers, is their ability to teach the scheme and make it understandable so the players can digest and execute on game days. And he's got a great scheme. It doesn't matter. Like I said, it doesn't matter who's running the ball. It doesn't matter who the quarterback is. They've gotten top level play out of them. He hasn't had that top level quarterback other than he had Matt Ryan, obviously, in Atlanta. But he's had success wherever he's gone calling plays. So I went with number five, Kyle Shanahan.
Okay. Cool. I went Arthur Smith and / Dennis Allen. So I think when I look at them struggling offensive line, didn't have Calvin Johnson a lot. They still scored 460 points last year. I think that, you know, he did a really good job unlocking things in Tennessee. So I think the more weapons he gets, they still need, their defense is going to be horrible. So I'm not sure how they're going to function next year in Atlanta, but they should continue to score points. Kyle Pitts, you got Drake, you got Brian Edwards, Drake London there as well. So we'll have to see how those weapons kind of feed into each other. I know that the kid from Cincinnati, he likes a lot. He'd been talking about how who knows? I think at the season starts, Mariota is going to start, but Mariota doesn't play 17 games. And I think, the rookie will come in and play at some point, but I do like him as a play caller. I kind of went at my four. I kind of went with Arthur Smith and Dennis Allen. I think Dennis Allen, a guy who can continuously stump Tom Brady, like continuously, like they just do a great job against Tom Brady all the time. And they've always been a kind of an attacking defense, a defense that you can do that does multiple things. They can rush, they can stay back in coverage. They can, they can blitz and do some unique things there. I like Dennis Allen. I think Dennis Allen could do a good job as a head coach if they can get that quarterback situation right out there in New Orleans. You're number four?
Yeah, I went Leslie Frazier, defensive coordinator up at Buffalo. You know, Buffalo, outside of Tre'Davious White, doesn't have a ton of star power on defense. They have good players. They don't have star players. They've never had, like, the elite pass rusher to come off the edge, but he's always pieced it together with the scheme, whether it's Jerry Hughes, Ed Oliver, those kind of guys. And you know, the way he teaches those secondary players, you know, what he's gotten out of those safeties and Micah Hyde and Jordan Poyer, what he's got out of Tre'Davious White, Levi Wallace. So he's a great secondary coach. I think he's got a good scheme. And like I said, he's done a lot, but not a ton in the stable as far as like star quality edge rushers. So I like Leslie Frazier up in Buffalo.
Yeah. Okay. I like Leslie Frazier too. See number three, where is it? We go with the Walrus here. I've always respected Andy Reid. I can't like just throw him away. I think that when I watch them on film, I think he does. He always still calls a. I know it's supposed to be Eric Bieniemy, but I mean his hand is still in this offense, no question about it. And they always score points, always find plays. He gets his prime time players the football in critical situations, whether it's Kelce, whether it's Tyreek Hill. They just know. I mean, we can say whatever we want about the defense in that Buffalo game, but you know he gets his players the ball when they need it. So and he's been doing it for a long period of time. He did it with some of these suspect quarterbacks too as well. So out there in Philly, all the way to Patrick Mahomes, who's one of the best quarterbacks in the league. So I go with Andy Reid at number three.
I went Sean McVay at number three. The only thing I need to say is he went to the Super Bowl with Jared Goff as his quarterback. So I don't know if I need to get too further down into the list than that.
That's it. Yes, you don't need to say anything else besides that. Oh, man, that's funny. I was going to say, we're number two. Number two now. So I'm going to go with Brian Leftwich. I know it might seem a little high, but I do think that for him in this moment with Tom Brady, I'm saying to myself, I feel like it's very difficult to do what he's doing with Tom Brady. I think he's a very calming influence. I like the fact that he just said, hey, if things aren't right for me, as much as the Jags job would be perfect, I feel like I'm not going to go there. And I respect him to kind of not jumping at that first job and kind of waiting. And that's tough for him because he might not, that means he might not get another opportunity. You never know. I mean, you never know when the next opportunity is going to come for you as a coordinator. But I do like the mix of him. I know it's Tom's offense, but he kind of was bridging the gap between what the old coach wanted to do at Arians and what Tom wanted to do. They kind of struggled a little bit, but now they kind of seem like they're on the right track out there. And I think he will get an opportunity to be a head coach at some point.
Yeah, and number two, I went, you know, you've already mentioned Andy Reid. I have Andy Reid at number two. Just, you know, the ability to morph the offense to the strengths of the players he has, whether that's Alex Smith, whether that's Patrick Mahomes, Travis Kelce, you know, incorporating a dynamic receiver like Tyreek Hill, running the ball this year or this past year when he needed to a little bit more. He had Donovan McNabb. He won with Donovan McNabb over in Philadelphia. He hasn't had the success probably in the postseason that he would have liked, but, you know, from week one through 16, some of the gadget plays, you know, the timing of when he calls these plays, is pretty good. So I would put him number two.
All right. So I went with one of your guys. I went with Sean McVay, and I just look at how many targets. So I'm looking at how many targets that Cooper Kupp was able to amass. So Cooper Kupp had 191 targets last year, and then he had 145 receptions. Also, Cooper Kupp's middle name is my last name. I didn't realize his last name, but his middle name was Douglas. But that just means that this team, he knows what he's doing offensively. Like, he can get that. When the game was on the line against the Niners, when the game was on the line against the Bengals, when the game was on the line against the Bucks, when the Bucks almost came back and off that lead, he just, you know, that everybody was probably saying, you know, do we really want to, let's make sure we cover number 10. And they still got the ball to him. I think that is something that I can't wait to see if, in those critical moments, can Josh McDaniels do that with Derek Carr and Davante Adams? But that's going to be huge for me because it's really such a critical thing. Like, when the game is on the line, can you get your best players the football? And he's been able to do that at just a high level. They won a Super Bowl last year, and you know, I think that's part of it. And you mentioned it. You mentioned it as well. Like, I'll take the Jared Goff thing even further. If Brandon Cooks catches a perfectly thrown ball by Jared Cook, this could be the second Super Bowl for him. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they were inches away from winning that game against the Patriots. They were just inches away from winning that. And I think also he didn't coach the same. Like, it seemed like he was tight, wasn't ready for that big moment in the Super Bowl. It could have been probably because you know, he has Jared Goff, and Bill Belichick is like, oh, this dude can't throw left. I'm not even gonna worry about him because he throws the ball to the right every single time. But yeah, I do like McVay as the best guy. People are gonna immediately say I didn't have Shanahan on the list. I like Shanahan. I think his offense is nice because it's kind of weatherproof for a West Coast team. You can run it anywhere. And I think he showed that when he was when they beat Green Bay. But I like my list. I'm gonna keep it that way. I don't know if you said this or not, but did you say that he took Kaepernick or no? Okay, was Kaepernick Harbaugh or?
Yeah, that was Harbaugh.
Yeah, it was Harbaugh. He took Garoppolo. They're replacing Garoppolo. We know Garoppolo is not a big time quarterback. Otherwise, they would not be replacing him. As far as that goes. Another list we had talked about today was our favorite Raider wide receivers I wouldn't say of all time. It's just it's ones that we have either seen play live or just in our lifetime. So I didn't want to. When you get to the top, it's pretty good, but it's not great on the bottom part. But I do think I will leave it with this caveat that I feel like these guys would have been much better if they just had better quarterback play. You talk about people who play with, like, I'm looking at people who play with Jay Schrader, who play with like some of these really bad quarterbacks the Raiders had for all those years. Number five, I have a couple of names here. One is Willie Gault / Jerry Porter. Like both of those guys, I like the Jerry Porter is kind of a hybrid wide receiver. Jerry Porter was kind of that guy who was a little bit like when Kobe played with Pau Gasol and they had Lamar Odom. Like, you know, when Lamar Odom had a big game, the game was over because Kobe and Pau Gasol were going to get theirs. I thought same thing with Jerry Porter. I thought when Jerry Porter had a big game, then it was just almost impossible to deal with the Raiders because of what they had with Tim Brown and Jerry Rice.
No, definitely. And on the play callers, my last one was Bill Belichick.
Clearly, oh, sorry.
I forgot that. Best coordinator. This top five Raiders receivers, when we talked about it today, I was kind of excited. You know, I jumped on Pro Football Reference. I quickly realized they haven't had. I was Googling like Andre Rison and how many yards did he have. This list is not very deep when you take off the Fred Biletnikoffs, the Cliff Branches, as you said.
Yep.
We weren't allowed to include tight ends, so no Todd Christensen. Not that Ricky Dudley would have made my list, but we couldn't use him. So I was kind of joking, you know, Doakie Williams was kind of my guy in the mid-80s, and he's actually in the top 20 all-time Raider receivers, which is interesting. But for number five, I did go to the 80s. I went Swervin, Mervin, Fernandez, and Jerry Porter were kind of the guys. I liked Mervin Fernandez. You know, he played, I believe him and Willie Gault were on the same team there in the mid to late 80s. That was the Mark Wilson. Might have been Steve Pedro.
Steve Berline. He was from the Canadian Football League, right?
I don't know that. I think he was. I just remember I was about 9-10 years old when he got to the Raiders in 1987, and he had some good years. And you know, I kind of paired him with Jerry Porter, kind of 5A, 5B, as you mentioned. Jerry Porter, he was kind of like the first big slot when the Raiders went 11 personnel. You had Rice and Brown, and Porter worked up in the slot there, was able to win some matchups. He had that big game against the Steelers that I believe and won a Gannon's first seasons with him. They went on the road and beat Pittsburgh, and Porter went off. But he kind of, you know, you're waiting for him to take that next step, and he never did in his career. But he, you know, believe it or not, he is eighth all-time in Raiders receiving yards. And if you take out tight ends and running backs.
Crazy!
Eighth. If you take out tight ends and running backs. So if you take Christensen, Powell, and Allen off the list, he's fifth in wide receivers at 3,939 yards. Shout out to Ronald Curry, who was close to making my list. You know, I was a big Ronald Curry guy too. Loved watching him play basketball. That catch he had in Denver in the back of the end zone in the snow will go down all time. But those would be my fifth guys. I would say Fernandez and Porter.
I'm going to say, like, you gave an honorable mention. I'm going to give an honorable mention to Lewis Murphy. Lewis Murphy gets an honorable mention here. He has some big catch, especially that game winner against the Steelers with Bruce Gradkowski at quarterback. My five, I have two guys there. I did Willie Gault and Porter already. Number four is Denarius Moore. He just didn't. Denarius just didn't give us any more. The guy was the guy was ridiculous. I mean, he was ridiculously talented. I mean, he was a great receiver. I'll never forget the catch he had down the right sideline from Carson Palmer when he caught the back half of the football against the Chargers in that win in San Diego. That was just that was cool. So my number four favorite Raider receiver was Denarius Moore.
Yeah, I went more new school. I went Michael Crabtree. Just, you know, he was really good in a short amount of time. And like I said, this list isn't very deep. So we're not passing over guys that had 5, 6, 7 yards. But, you know, just the ability to come in, you know, the way he won in the short area, you know, he didn't have long speed. The way he competed for balls in the air, he won those jump balls, those fade routes. And, you know, his numbers are pretty good as a Raider. He scored 25 touchdowns in 3 seasons. So
that's pretty good.
The ability to get in the end zone and just be a productive receiver for the Raiders in a short amount of time.
Yeah. Number three was Swerve Marvin Fernandez. For me, I just loved the name, nickname, obviously. And then obviously the way he played. And I didn't, like I said, like you said, I did not realize he was that high on the list. That's kind of crazy to think about that. You get all the Raiders. I mean, it just, they must have had, when those guys played back in the day, the Raiders must have really ran the ball way more than we think of, because we always see the Monica bomb to Blitnikoff or Branch, but they must have ran the ball way more than, because like, it just seemed like they would be like more.
We have tight ends too.
They did have tight ends. Did Casper and people like that. So yeah, it makes sense.
Christensen was their guy through most of the 80s. He was their top target. And then you had Marcus Allen out of the backfield, too. My number three guy is Hunter Renfrow. I know that he's a younger guy. He hasn't ascended up this list yet, but I think in due time he will. Just the craftiness, the ability to win in short areas. And I think when all is said and done, I would be surprised if Hunter Renfrow doesn't crack the top five of this list when his career is over, if not higher. The bar is not very high for wide receivers. James Jett is fourth at 4,400 yards. And Hunter Renfrow is already halfway there.
And I think too, with this Raider team too, it seems like drafting one, them staying, and then like going through their whole career with the Raiders has not happened. You've seen this, maybe they just grab people at the end of their careers. So like, also like for mine, I have Hunter Renfrow / Michael Crabtree at number two. So yeah, I think, I mean, Hunter Renfrow has the best opportunity to be a guy who stays with the Raiders and just kind of like rewrites the record books, as far as, I mean, you got him and Waller back-to-back years, get 100 catches. So that's a big possibility there. And Crabtree was the red zone target. You know, so many big catches, the sliver of blue, the 2-point conversion against the Saints in that game. You know, that was a game where I think, you know, Jalen Richard had that huge run. I thought we had a huge running back too, with Jalen Richard as well too, but it didn't work out that way. Who's your number one? I think that number one has to be, I don't know, for me, it's and I know who it is, but maybe.
Yeah. Well, number two, I came in with Jerry Rice, you know.
Okay, cool.
Short period of time. Jerry came over 3 years, went 3,286 yards, 18 touchdowns, you know, just combining him with Brown and then getting to the Super Bowl, you know, I was an Andre Rison guy too, but, you know, he didn't have enough yards to make my list. And clearly number one is Tim Brown. There's no one else that even matches.
There's nobody else.
I mean, we could do a top five of who could have been, like the Johnny Lee Higgins, the Chaz Schillings of the world.
Schillings.
Those guys.
Touched up. I remember the big catch he had against the Ravens.
Rocket Ismail.
So many guys like that. It's crazy. Yeah, it's
they just never panned out. I mean,
never. And the Raiders made it. The Raiders were unique in that way. It was kind of crazy. So we did have some other kind of guessing back and forth right now of who, and I will write these down too to see who's right on these two as well, as far as more yards, DeMarcus Robinson or Matt Collins. Who do you think is going to have more yards here? Because it all depends on reps, obviously. But let me make my Dwayne side and Ryan side to see who is going to be see if we're going to be right or going to be on the same page as far as some of these go. So who's going to have more yards? You think Robinson or Hollins?
I'm going to go Hollins. I think he's going to get more opportunities and catch a couple of the deep balls. So I'm leaning towards the Mac Hollins camp for more receiving yards this year as that third option for the Raiders.
Yeah, I believe that same concept. I just feel like he might be a guy who blocks more. And so I feel like when they want to run the football, I can just see them running, you know, ripping off like a couple of big runs, and then all of a sudden he slips behind a safety or a corner and make a big play down the field. And also he's a good special teams player too. So it's all about reps. I think we agree on the Hollins thing. So I do. I'm not sure if I love DeMarcus Robinson, but I kind of like Hollins a little bit better. More yards from scrimmage, Drake or White?
This is a tough one because scrimmage yards includes catches.
Yeah.
So who's going to catch the ball more, but who's going to, you know, White might dig into some of those carries. I'm going to lean Drake on this one just because of the receiving yards. I think White might have more rushing yards, but I'm not sure the Raiders are going to use him in the passing game as much as a rookie. I would not be surprised if we look back and White actually wins this category, but I'm going to say Drake.
I mean, you feel like he's going to catch the ball in the backfield too as well.
Yeah, I also think that Brandon Bolden is going to get some of those catches that we think are going to go to Drake. So I think Drake's numbers aren't going to quite be what we think they're going to be. And I think White might make a late run in the second half of the schedule and on the calendar and get some yards on the ground.
More INTs, Rock Ya-Sin or Trayvon Mullen? I think I'm probably going to roll with Rock Ya-Sin. I mean, I like Mullen. I thought he'd be more of an impact player than he is right now, but I'm not saying this is his last chance because he's a starting NFL or, you know, a fringe NFL starter. I mean, but, you know, Anthony Everett, like there's competition there. So he's going to get pushed. So we'll have to see what happens there. But I don't know what his injury is, but I think Rock Ya-Sin being a guy who is like healthy, ready to go right now. That could obviously change with training camp or a preseason game, but I kind of like Rock Ya-Sin here over Trayvon Mullen.
Yeah, I think that's close. I'm a Mullen believer as a number two cornerback in this league. I'm going to say Ya-Sin just because I think he's going to get more passes thrown his way and because he's probably going to be covering the number one receiver more often. Just due to opportunity, I wouldn't be surprised if Mullen, if he's healthy and he plays the whole season, wins this category. Mm-hmm. But the odds and the probabilities are probably leaning towards Rock Ya-Sin. So I'm going to use the analytics and go with Ya-Sin here.
Okay. So let's see here. So Max Crosby, Chandler Jones, more sacks. This is a good one. And I mean, like, they're going to be – it depends because, like, I mean, they're going to be moving around. I don't know what – I don't know if Patrick Graham is going to, you know, – he's probably licking his chops to have both of these guys there. I'm going to go out there and just go with Crosby and just say, you know what, a lot of those pressures that should have turned into sacks last year – are going to be sacks this year because on the back end, they're going to be better because they have a better coach back there instead of just being, you know, Gus Bradley drop back and cover three all the time. So I'm going to go Crosby in this matchup.
I'm going to go Jones. And this is probably the unpopular opinion. I think offensive coordinators are going to focus more on Crosby. He's younger. He's a guy that you have to deal with. I think, you know, some people might think Jones is getting up in there in age. Other than the big sack game he had against the Titans last year, where he had five. Other than that, he kind of didn't have his normal season. But I think he was getting a lot of attention in Arizona because there wasn't a Robin to his Batman on the other side. So I think all the attention is going to go to Crosby here, and Jones is going to win a ton of one-on-one battles. Mm-hmm. I think they both get double digits, but I'm going to go with the savvy veteran and say Chandler Jones ekes him out with more sacks.
I could definitely see that. I can see coordinators saying, let's make sure Crosby doesn't get anything, and then we'll take our chances with Chandler Jones, and then next thing you know, he has three sacks in the first quarter, or the first half of the game, so they have to deal with that as far as that goes. All right, last one, we have more TDs, Jacobs or Renfro. That is like, oh man, that's a really tough one, because you got to figure in the red zone. White is around, but I do feel like they're going to give, Jacobs the ball as much as possible, especially with the way his style is, and he does have a nose for the end zone. So I think he could be a factor there as far as that goes. And for Renfro, everything's going to be spread out offensively. So I don't know. That's a tough one. I'm going to go Renfro just because of games played. Not that Jacobs misses a lot of games, but I do think there's more opportunity. I feel like Jacobs is not going to – I think Jacobs could be a guy who they might go to him in some goal line. They might go to some of the Bolden or whoever else in their packages for running the football. So I'm going to go Renfro there, even though it's going to be tough because you got Waller and you got Davante Adams.
Yeah, I'm going to lean Jacobs here because, like you said, I think Adams is going to eat up some of those red zone targets. And then I think Waller, they're going to actually use Waller properly in the red zone, unlike prior regimes. And Josh McDaniels will run the football in the red zone. He's not averse to it.
He will.
Sony Michel had a couple of big years in the red zone, and they may use Jacobs is going to get rested. He's not going to be carrying the ball 20, 25 times. So they're going to pick their shots with him. And I think that they're going to use him inside the 10-yard line a little bit here. And then I think he might sneak a couple of catches for touchdowns too. So that might be the difference maker. He might get 6 or 7 on the ground, but he might get 2 or 3 in the air, and that gets him to 8 or 9. I think Renfro is going to catch 100 balls. I just don't know how often he's going to get into the end zone.
Yeah. I just wanted to see, I'm going to check real quick before we go. I just want to see how many rushing touchdowns the Patriots had last year. They rushing. Who were they? New England. I probably searched New England Patriots more in this year on my computer than ever in my entire life. It's just 10-7, lost the playoffs last year. Their rushing stats. Yeah.
So they were tied for second in the league at 1.3 touchdowns per game. So that probably puts them in the low 20s.
They had 24 touchdowns.
Yeah.
Damian Harris had 15. Ramon Stevenson had 5. And then Brandon Bolden had 1. And then James White had 1 of the rushing touchdowns. So they had 24 rushing touchdowns. Rushing touchdowns. So
it's a pretty big number.
Yeah. So see, they're running football. So they get in the end zone. But he's not afraid to run the football down there. So, all right, Raider Nation, we'll be that wraps up the show for right now. We will return next week, and we'll see you next time. Peace.
Take care.
Cool. All right, fake ending.